All right, welcome everybody from the Mecklenburg County Sportsplex in Matthews, North Carolina. It is the championship D1AA match between Bowling Green State University and the University of Tennessee. And I'm Alex Goff with Katie Wirst welcoming you to this championship game. Katie, this is a matchup between two storied club programs, and not varsity programs, but they have been around for decades.
Yes, fantastic competition that we are going to have here, Alex. We've already tuned into the men's Division II competition, and this is the point of the day when the action continues to heat up here at Mecklenburg County Sports Complex. There's going to be quite a bit of physical play between both these sides, Tennessee and Bowling Green. Fantastic bit of rugby that we've seen. They're always contenders here for the championship as we move forward.
Well, you see Tennessee with their big, powerful front row, Braxton Hurd, Greg Gianduglio, and Kevin Thomas, and then Bowling Green, and they've got a fantastic 12-13 combination in the very speedy Joe Johnson and Tony Mock, who's a freshman. And in fact, they've managed to put together a very nice combination, these two.
Head coach for Tennessee is Marty Bradley, and captain is Marcus McLean. He's wearing the number 10 strip as we get going.
Jake Kubicki kicks it off deep, sends it deep, and Lance Williams gathers it in, volunteers now, just going to punch it up. There goes Hurd. That, in fact, is... I think that's Greg Janowicz. They get the penalty. We're going to be talking a lot, I think, about penalties in the breakdown as players try to poach that ball, Katie, and it's always a bit of a bit fraught in the breakdown as kick goes to touch. And remember, when there's a penalty, if you kick it to touch, that's your team's throw in. There's a nice ground gainer there for Tennessee, and they're going to get the throw in. Greg Gianduglio.
And to get it started, Ben Dickinson is the match official for this restart.
Janowicz, nice take, and just a very solid little maul, just held it on there. Quickly, the backs go to work. Tennessee sending Pellini up the middle. And again, distributed out by McLean, Marcus McLean, diminutive fly half. Working nicely with Luke Davies. Big tackle there from Bowling Green, and the ball spills forward, and immediately a message sent.
Very tough one to handle there for Tennessee. The mark's just a little bit too high off the mark, but low body position in the tackle contest. And it seems both teams are trying to play sort of a cool, calm, collected approach, but the nerves are real, Alex. I mean, this is the big championship platform, this stage here that we have, beautiful field here in Matthews Sports Complex in Mecklenburg County.
They have circled this game for sure, and they had some tough games to get here. Tennessee having to get past a very tough Kentucky team and a very tough Clemson team. Bowling Green with their rivalry with Western Michigan. You hear the sound of the fans. There goes Johnson. Running a little switch crash with him. Digging it out once again. The Falcons, and didn't have the handle. Stuhldreher wasn't able to get it. He gets hit, doesn't like it, but it was a perfectly legitimate hit. And you see a good drive there from Bowling Green, Katie. And scrum number one win probably for Bowling Green.
Yeah, beautiful, nice low body position, good drive set forward. You hear the Bowling Green fans really getting behind that one. There's nothing more enjoyable than scrum dominance, especially at the very beginning. So Coach Tony Mazzarella is certainly going to be happy about that, driving forward. Also the Bowling Green captain, Kyle Sikora.
Sikora right there in the middle of the front row as it gets ready to pack down. Luke Davies to put the ball in for Tennessee. One of the taller scrum halves you'll see.
Right, quite a height differential there for sure.
And looking to connect with, is that going backwards? Wallace unable to pick that up. And Katie, we talked about being a little frantic, you know, and a little bit impatient. And Thomas Wallace picks that up, you know, 9 times out of 10. This time just fumbled it forward.
Great from Ravenswood High School. He's definitely a student athlete that puts a lot of time and effort into his sport.
So now you've got Ryan Niemiller. Niemiller, out of the Clayton program in North Carolina. Played for Atlantis. Kubicki sends it high. It's going to be a little bit trouble, but well fielded, chip ahead. And then taken by Choate. He goes straight up ahead. Janowicz takes him down. Kubicki again sends it down the field. Again taken by White. And punch downfield very nicely. And just rolls into in goal. And referee is going to say, we've got a goal line dropout. Remember, that's still a net gain. Kick down the field, you get a goal line dropout. That's not bad for Tennessee.
And you get the sense that it's going to be quite a chess match here, back and forth, utilizing the kicking game opportunity. All about the territory, right? Placing the ball in positions to where you can launch an attack.
Jake Rath and Josh Shelter getting those kicks downfield for Tennessee. There goes the dropout. Bounces first before it goes into touch, so that will be a line out. And we saw in the previous game where the dropout went straight into touch, and that ends up being a 5-meter scrum to the receiving team. So that's a, that's something you want to avoid. But here, line out, because it rolled into touch first, to line out for Tennessee.
Right, just having awareness of the law changes, things that have come up recently, can be so helpful for team in terms of making great decisions when it counts the most. And no points on the board yet. We got to set the tone.
Janowicz is their go-to man in the line-out. He's really nice take, taken forward. The maul goes to ground, and a penalty. Janowicz is going to tap quickly. Get low, the big man going to the corner. Tennessee likes it, referee likes it. Try volunteers.
And the volunteers are putting their hand up right now to get the points on the board, doing phenomenal work. Greg Janowicz from Barrington High School. He's a team MVP in 2019 and really just putting the team on his back right now, making some things happen early for Tennessee.
Well, the ball was right there on his feet and able to just go to the referee and tap it. Power over. Guy that size, pretty difficult to stop. Well, that makes it 5-0. Here we are just 6.5 minutes into the game.
And Greg Janowicz, the animal science major, sometimes also moonlights at flanker as well, but certainly happy in the place he's in right now, is the first try scorer of this contest. Tennessee up on the board early within the first 7 minutes, 5 points.
Well, I think that Marty Bradley made a decision based on mobility and perhaps look for a more mobile back row and get your big powerful man in at second row. Meanwhile, Janowicz can play eight, can play six, and here doing just fine. And what a kick from the touchline. And Katie, that's kind of not only an extra 2 points, but an emotional boost. Have a look at this thing from the touchline all the way through. Terrific skill from Jake Rath.
And that's the one that just wobbles over the crossbar, exactly what you need. Each point is gonna matter here. Tennessee starting it off right. Bowling Green's gonna look to absolutely make a counter.
Well taken, right there, a missed tackle. All kinds of problems for Bowling Green. That's Luke Mathis, Janowicz. And quickly picked up again, Wallace. Dug out by Davies, McLean, working to use Pellini. And then right up the middle, problems for Bowling Green once again. Tennessee just taking it to them. Hurd picking and going. They're right under the post. It's right there for them. Couple of missed tackles by Bowling Green. They won't be happy. Once again, just ready to just take it to the line. They got to be careful, though. They don't want to get it held up. Once again to the line. Referee's right there watching it. The pick and go.
Nice recovery from Bowling Green on the goal line. Stand defense right on the line.
There's your man again. Janowick. That big, that powerful. Look at that. And he puts his hand up in triumph. And, you know, I don't blame him. What a powerful presence in tight.
Class of 2022. He's a phenomenal student athlete, animal science major, looking like a beast out here himself, just doing great work. Janowick having just the match of his life. Look at this beautiful breakthrough. Excellent effort there. Plenty of space to work with Josh Shelter.
Well tackled, but Shetler, that was the big one. And then they were, Katie, look how smart they were down at the goal line.
Right, and Bowling Green just doing everything they can right on the line, made like two or three really close tackles, just held him out. But eventually the levee's going to break and you're going to get over. Tennessee couldn't ask for a better start here, up 12 points to zero. Bowling Green, they would like to roll back the clock and restart everything.
10 minutes in, Rath going for the extras. He got one from the touchline. This one just a little bit to the left of the posts. No problem at all. And that's right, when the levee breaks, you have no place to stay. Where are they going to find a home, Bowling Green? You got to make that tackle for sure.
And Tennessee, it's all about momentum right now. They're just driving forward. They got a number of big bodies that are so difficult to tackle. Alex, if you're Bowling Green, you have to do something to just sort of stop the bleeding, right? Well, do whatever you can to control, get back to composure, start playing your system, and really just get the ball. You need
Travis
possession.
Reba is on the field right now, number 23, put on the right wing. And I don't know if that is a tactical or an injury sub, but that's pretty early. Rath, you kick it to Rath, he's going to return it with interest. Big looping pass, now taken, Capizzi. A dropped ball. Volunteers are just surging forward. Janowick, Wallace, working it out. Thomas, nice pass from the prop forward. And Tennessee just consolidating. Back out it comes, Hurd cuts it back, Janowick is on his hip. Back out to McLean, looking to use Pellini. Janowick again. Certainly, could he get his third one? No, he lets it squirt loose. Good tackle there from John Hooper. But offside against Bowling Green in the end, Katie, and a little bit of life defensively from Bowling Green.
You get a look here, Janowick saying, hey, give me the ball. I've got the hot of hands, let's go for it, and they get it out. They move it so quickly to get outside, but Bowling Green does really well to sort of stop that onrush.
And going for the lineout once more, and we'll see, maybe they'll try to maul it at this time, just 5 meters from the line. Up 14-0 already. Tennessee has smacked Bowling Green in the mouth quite hard. And looking to consolidate right now.
Looks like it potentially could have been like a blood sub.
Yeah.
Again, that effort again, Bowling Green having to make a quick change, something they've got to get themselves back in the rhythm, right, of what they're looking for. If you're Tennessee here, take advantage of this line out. They definitely have a size advantage, and there are certainly some opportunities to move the ball.
And Janowick just takes it, goes himself. Oh, he didn't even need a ball. He just goes all by himself, and it is another try for Greg Janowick, and it is another try for Tennessee.
I believe that one was maybe William Ring.
Oh, sorry. Well, you know, Blonde hair is blonde hair. Thank you, Katie. William Ring goes in. And this one, though they didn't set anything up, he just went all on his own.
Right, I mean, just really great awareness. We'll take another look here at the replay for the lineout. Goes back deep, just gets to ground real quick, and Bowling Green just gets on the wrong side of it. He just flips it over, and good awareness of where the try line is right away, and that's what you need.
John Hooper saw it. No one else saw it. And another try for Tennessee. And I have to say, not to toot my own horn or anything, in the Golf Rugby Report D1AA rankings, you will see that Tennessee is ranked number one, and Bowling Green ranked number five, but they are the two highest ranked non-varsity or non-school supported teams in the D1AA rankings. The Tennessee has not lost. They beat Ohio State earlier in a preseason game, as Rath puts it up, does not quite get this one over, so it'll stay 19-0. But they have not lost, and they are in an extremely tough conference with teams like, you know, you can't turn your nose up at Georgia, who played extremely well this year, and Clemson was a fantastic team this year, as was Kentucky and Tennessee. Amusingly, Marty Bradley, when he sent me a supposedly confidential note about where he thought teams stood at the beginning of the SCRC season, he put Tennessee at number three in his own conference. And maybe a little bit of underselling. There we go with Braxton Hurd taking it up for Tennessee. Bowling Green hardly seen the ball. Box kick from Davies. It takes a little bit of a goofy bounce. Beautifully taken, though, by Konstantinos Anderson. Bowling Green now. So, Giuliano Chesnick, excuse me. And a penalty, not releasing the tackle player. Bowling Green just going to settle it down.
And here was the look, really, that bouncy. He timed it perfectly just to scoop it up. Right, and here was the opportunity. Now Bowling Green, they've got the opportunity here to really sort of keep composure. They're in good field position. This is the chance they can get on the board and really start sort of righting the ship.
Sikora, no, actually throwing in will be Stuhldreher, John Stuhldreher, the flanker. And they have as their first receivers the ball, not really controlled. Knocked forward by Tennessee first. And Katie, I'm sure they were hoping to make that one count.
Yeah, certainly. Just, you know, a little bit of a miscue. And now we're going back to the opportunity for the scrum. There's just such a size advantage here for Tennessee. It's definitely something that they've been taking advantage of. I mean, Alex, you got to talk about the fact that both members of the engine room, number four and number five for Tennessee, are the try scorers so far. And that's just got to be a difficult day when you're going to be scrummaging all the time.
Yes, that's true. And we see Ryan Niemiller putting the ball in for Bowling Green. At the back of that scrum, Nico LaBianca has had a fantastic season. He's looking to pick that up, but that ball is not coming out the back of the scrum. And the drive by Tennessee. And you can hear the crowd. They love it. It's a knowledgeable rugby crowd, and they know.
I mean, it truly is an excitable crowd here, and that's just the little things that make the enthusiasm happen for Tennessee. So if you're Bowling Green, you got to think about how do you get that ball out fast, right? But the first scrum of the match, if you bring it back, Bowling Green had the decidable advantage. They were much lower. They had good body position. So it's interesting to see sort of that punch, counter punch going back and forth.
Once again with the line out for Tennessee, this one just about 7 meters inside the Bowling Green half. Tennessee 19, Bowling Green 0. Oh, not quite controlled, but in comes Thomas. Cleans it up, Braxton Hurd. Taken down by Sikora. Dug out by Davies, McLean. Looking to get Panini going again. And then Stettler back inside. Really good ball movement from Tennessee. Can they get it quickly? They have numbers to the right. So many numbers. busting through the tackles. Bowling Green needs to be stronger in that tackle, right down to the line. Back to the big guys. Janowick. Picked up again, this time by Thomas. And again, off to the, over the line. Well, it looked like they might have scored. They might have scored with that one, and they have. And yep, there it is. I credited him with a try that he hadn't scored. But this time, Greg Janowick gets his third try. Pick and go, stays low. And once again, Katie, that was all about that break.
And this is some absolutely gorgeous continuity. I mean, this is the definition of how you make continuous play happen for Tennessee. And it's so wonderful to see the interplay between forwards and backs. And then it's just once they get anywhere close to the line, it's going to be really difficult to keep them out of the end goal.
Luke Mathis was the flanker in support there, doing nice work for them.
Janowick, just absolutely phenomenal. Originally from Illinois, went to Barrington High School. He has just been absolutely on fire. I mean, it's 18 minutes in here. He's got three tries. I don't know what's going to stop him.
Well, his name has come up a lot this year, but I don't think I remember him scoring three tries for them. Well, the game plan is working for sure. And then you saw Luke Mathis come in on the hip of Tom Panini. And Panini has been playing well. They've been trying to get him to go through. Josh Shetler has made a couple of breaks on the centers, but certainly the centers are just getting it started for the big men to put it over. This one doesn't quite go over. We'll stay at 24-0, about midway through the first half. Tennessee in control. Bowling Green has got to think, well, we'd like our hands on the ball, if nothing else. Let's just get our hands on the ball.
I mean, it's really about possession, right? If you can retain it, if you can get it back and just absolutely settle, get yourself together, and things can really turn around.
Kubicki with the restart. Going deep. Mathis again takes it. They go wide, Wallace. Taken down nicely by Stoldreyer. Penalty going straight down on the ball, trying to poach it, but lost control and fell over. And that was, having a look, that was the flanker, Kobe Choate. And once again, so penalties, Katie, they can't afford penalties. They're down 24 points.
I mean, it's about just being frustrated, right? You know, you want to make sure that you can maintain possession, but you have to do it legally, right? How do you keep your feet? And there's just a lot of physical play going on. So doing whatever you can within the guidelines of the law to see how you can contest possession. Ball was back deep into that line out, but cleaned up without a problem.
McLean getting it, trying to get it out to Shetler. Johnson pouncing on it. That was exactly the sort of opportunistic chance he has really been thirsting for. No chance for Johnson to come in. No chance. He was hoping for that ball to bounce up into his hands.
Right, Joe Johnson, just an unlucky break, right? So the ball, like an uncharacteristic miss for the Volunteers as well. But, you know, we'll take it. It's a setup as a good scrum and decent field position. There's always a contest for the ball at the scrum.
Scrum down to Tennessee in the middle of the field. Luke Davies once again.
There's a good shot for Bowling Green.
Wallace has it. They're trying to just get it out the back there. Slow ball coming back for Tennessee. Hurd drives over. Out it comes. McLean, Pelini, trying to get it to Rath. Well tied up by Mock. Stoldreyer makes a tackle. Davies out to McLean once again. Williams. good, powerful run from him. And then just the inside pass to Wallace. Not quite there. Knocked forward. Little pat on the side from Cody Luther. And he always loved those little moments between opposition. Just sort of, hey, buddy, it's okay. It's all good. Supposed to be fun.
Right, absolutely. I mean, much better defense effort there from Bowling Green. Really a couple of good double tackles as well, pushing them back. And Volunteers having trouble breaking the gain line in this last series. So Bowling Green can keep them in good field position. They can just pour it on. And, you know, the more pressure you apply defensively, there's going to be some moments where mistakes happen. That's when they can capitalize.
And the ball coming out the back. LaBianca is going to run with it. But in the end, a penalty against Tennessee. An angle in the drive, and you can get carried away with the ascendancy in the scrum too, give away some penalties. And here you see on the near side, I don't know if you can see it, Chris Capisi, the number 11 for Bowling Green, he was off for a little bit with a blood sub. He has a purple tape wrapped around his head, covering up, I think, a cut on his scalp. And he's just a big purple tough guy at the moment.
And Bowling Green really has to take advantage of this. Excellent work in the scrum. Their body position's what's saving them in that set piece. And here is a solid opportunity if they can just push forward.
Good taking the line out from the Falcons, and they're gonna drive this one. That was John Hooper. And heard somebody complaining about getting poked in the eye. Kubicki now. He's got a little half gap. There's the fend. He takes a step. He's going to the line. Bowling Green in under the post. Jake Kubicki.
Phenomenal work, as we said. Bowling Green, it only takes one to get right back in it. They come charging forward. Excellent bit of individual effort there, but things were done and dusted at the set piece. Great effort from Kubicki. There's a nice fend off, and he just breaks a couple of tackles, sees the line, and dives for it.
Now, Greg Giulio trying to make that tackle. He's a little bit shorter than Kubicki, who's got a long reach and just fended him off. And, you know, we talk about emotion, too, in this one, Katie. This is something they needed. Bowling Green needed that big time.
Absolutely, certainly. I mean, the emotional control is all about making sure you can maintain and take your opportunities when they're there. Jake Kubicki from the Highland Buzzards Rugby Club, his high school team from Medina, Ohio, and he has absolutely put some fire underneath Bowling Green, and that's what we're looking for to make this a contest.
You see a lot of local produced players in Bowling Green. Rugby Ohio has a pretty robust group of teams. You see Stuldreyer and Johnson, both from St. Ignatius. You see Mock coming in from Archbishop Moeller, had a fantastic season this past year, and he was part of that. And then comes in Casacora from St. Edward, a couple of Hudson kids, Perrysburg. Well represented today in several teams, in fact, as the restart goes into in goal. It's not a great restart for Tennessee, and it's going to roll dead. And that's going to be a scrum center.
And again, Bowling Green just kind of going to take the opportunities as they come to them, which is really sort of at this point, and when you're climbing back into it, making some great decisions, right? Good mental choices. Are you aware of what you're going to be doing? And this is for Tennessee. It's you can't count your chips yet. You know, it's still very much, this is a championship matchup, Alex, so anything can happen.
Well, we know the Bowling Green's not just going to fold. They're going to find a way through, and they've already found a way to get that those 7 points back. That was critical. Now here's another potential momentum shift if they can make it work, but the scrum is still a problem for the Falcons at the moment. Well held there.
And that's that solid body position that we've been seeing, just getting that extra shove and that platform going forward on the front foot.
Chesnick takes it up. And again, you know, failure to roll away there. That was the thing. The tackler, who was The tackler was Josh Shetler, made the tackle, but then didn't roll away, and that's a penalty all day. And a missed touch.
And that's a tough mental error there, just not to miss touch, but they'll kick it all the way back down. Let's see how they counter.
Kubicki hoofs it back, everybody retreating. Kubicki racing in to get everybody onside. He does that along with Mark. And then the kick to touch. Shanked a little bit, and that will be a positive net for Bowling Green. They'll take the line out right around the 22-meter line. Sikora is calling for something as well. I'm not sure what his argument is with the referee, but he saw something that he wanted to let them know about. And as usual with referees, he's told to be quiet and go away.
I think you have to give so much credit to Kubicki as well, too, for really working to put his team on sides, putting the pressure right. It is very difficult when you're deep in there and you hear those footsteps coming at you, and that's what caused, you know, just that little bit of a shank to the kick. Bowling Green brings it down.
There's the drive. Hooper's right in the middle there. So is Zapiela. And hands in the ruck again. Penalty against Tennessee. Referee doesn't want to hear it. Kubicki lining up to kick another one. And Bowling Green storming back once more.
Referee Ben Dickinson, he has quite a contest on his hands here, managing a lot of this. And Tennessee, you get the sense of shaking that foundation a bit. Several penalties in a row, it can really start to mess with you.
Those are the second row players, John Hooper, Zachary Shapila, making it work there for Bowling Green. Hooper takes it, goes forward. Again, sort of that uncontested maul. LaBianca, a fend off, drives to the line. He's about 4 meters out. The pick and go by McBride. Hooper again. Closer edges. And the try is given. I think that was Nico LaBianca driving over. We'll have to check it. But Bowling Green is back in this ball game.
I mean, just clinical work there on the line out. We got to take a look at this and how they brought it down. You know, straight away, handled without a problem. Tennessee tries the second, actually makes them go forward. And Bowling Green just goes to work here, right? Here's the counter ruck, but they're quick to move the ball. And then you got to love just the fringe. They're going to pick it and go, pick it and go. Meter after meter and just keeping patient, right? Knowing that this is going to pay off, but it's all about support, right? If you go alone, there's nothing you can do. So how are they going to get over the line? And there it is.
Nico LaBianca and John Hooper were such a big part of the championship weekend, winning the MAC and getting past their longtime rivals Western Michigan in the final in the mud. And LaBianca gets the try.
LaBianca from Avon Lake Rugby Football Club, doing a phenomenal job. Played football in high school, and you can see it. Bowling Green fans have come alive. And this is such a contest, back and forth here still. Tennessee, they have to be thankful that they built that extra lead. Janowick through some great work. Really, those couple of extra tries in the bank are something that's going to matter.
And that was quite a kick there by Giuliano Chesnick to add the extras. From far out, and we've seen some impressive kicking so far today. 24-14, and suddenly it's not so much of a runaway.
I mean, Alex, we knew this was going to be a contest no matter what, and now it's just one where it's really about the emotions. Who's going to manage it best?
Well, there's a mistake from Bowling Green, gathered by Mock, but a pass to no one. It's not really helpful for them. Tennessee now looking to pin Bowling Green in, see what they can get out of it. Kubicki puts a boot to it. It rolls, gathered in by White. White puts on a move, taken down. Shetler, well rucked over by Tennessee. Now they're in the 22 on the front foot. Davies gets it to Williams. Davies digging it out again. McLean set up far to the right, but Janowick He's only got three tries this half. Maybe he wants another one. Out to McLean. Pops it inside to Ring, the other try scorer. Dug out again, McLean. Pellini, he skips past Pellini. Rath tackled by Mock. And a little bit of a knock on. Bowling Green kind of escapes that one.
Right, I think they just really sort of kept the pressure on, you know, did a good job of making sure that they could bend and not break in Tennessee. Eventually you're going to force the knock forward or something's going to happen where there's a miscue.
Now we'll get back with another scrum. Bowling Green looking to try to clear their lines a little bit. They've perhaps won the kicking game a little bit so far.
Kubicki on that last one, he's just ice in his veins, man. There's pressure coming on and he just clears the ball like it's no problem.
Just a little bit of negotiation as they put together the scrum. As happened, we got somebody with something in his eye. And in fact, that's Greg Gianguglio, the hooker.
You gotta love the vocal force of this crowd for both sides here. It is just an exceptional day to watch rugby. You gotta love when the crowd gets involved.
And both teams have traveled really well. A lot of players who know they're not gonna play, but have come anyway. Oh, the ball comes out, knocked forward. One of those little miscues, Knee Miller trying to pass it out, and the ball got hooked up on the leg of LaBianca and knocked forward. Scrum for Tennessee turns that right around.
Matt Tuck, just a lot of pressure from Tennessee for Knee Miller, trying to handle it as best he can. You mentioned from the local Clayton Rugby Club, just up the road a bit. Certain that his family's tuning in or here in person. You gotta love seeing so many of these athletes are looking for opportunities for Major League Rugby. You gotta love the career goal. What's our aspirations? Let's play professional rugby. We absolutely love that.
Luke Davies getting ready to put in, and he's one from up in Connecticut, Aspetuck Rugby Club. A great high school program up there, and he's also played for the USA South U19s when they were playing in, you know, before COVID, we got things like international tournaments where you could play in the Caribbean, in the Rugby America's North Under-19 Championship. And it's his experience has been so crucial for them.
Quite a back and forth here with this scrum put in.
Wallace picks it up. He's going to go left. Davies let that out. Oh, he was almost through. Just ankle tap by Knee Miller. Davies picks it up. Now they're going to ruck it over. Williams gets a little bit closer. Is he over? Referee says held up. And somebody, I think that was Knee Miller, got right under that ball. Wouldn't let Lance Williams touch it down. We're going to go back to a penalty.
Credit to referee Dickinson for getting right in there so we can see front row spot.
Tap by Janowick. They were watching for that one. They were ready for him. Another pick and go. Once again, right at the line. Referee is down on the ground. Yes, it's a try. Try for Tennessee. And right back, what an answer from the Volunteers as halftime looms, and a big one, Katie.
Right, Janowick, they absolutely did throw everything but the kitchen sink at him. He was trying to do everything they can to keep him out, but they're just on the line here, right? And that goal line defense is so draining over and over. The pressure's on. See referee Dickinson, perfect position to make the call.
Now he went down low and he was just on the line. And I'm not sure because it might have been Wallace and it might have been someone else. Wallace or potentially Mathis.
I mean, certainly just a back row tight five right. Sort of effort to get over that line, right? That there was just not one person. Maybe they would have actually got it over the line. defensively, Bowling Green, just valiant effort. It's just they're too difficult to defend when you get there.
I remember that came partly from having a scrum that then they knocked the ball on, so they gave the scrum put in away to Tennessee. The kick is good. 31-14. And Tennessee regains a little bit of the upper hand.
All right, Alex, remember, it took no time at all for Bowling Green just to sort of calm, collectively move down the field, make some great decisions, draw a few penalties, and get right back into this. So you get the sense that that's going to be what's going to happen next. Tennessee's got to find a way to sort of keep that momentum going.
Jake Kubicki with the restart again. He's been kicking them relatively deep. This one goes deep as well. Mathis gets under it. Going to go straight up. And he's isolated a little bit. And yes, that'll happen. A terrific poach there from Bowling Green, from their number one, Ryan McBride. And he gets the congratulations. Bowling Green gets the penalty. And a chance just before the break to get something back for the Falcons.
And Ryan McBride, I mean, you love the enthusiasm up from that, because that's just an effort-based hustle-type play, right? He's a crossover athlete, football and baseball. He was actually the lineman of the year, right? Played for Walsh Jesuit. He's just absolutely put Bowling Green in the best position they can be as the minutes start to tick away.
Hooper takes it. They set the maul. Sikora comes in to pull that back. Choate's in there, too. The drive keeps going. LaBianca, he's over. It's a try for Bowling Green. Just like that, they take it back.
Nico LaBianca, he makes it look easy. Second try of the day. He was the danger man the first time around. He just absolutely never say die for Bowling Green. And look at it, it's right again. Draw the penalty, create a great set piece, which they have clearly worked for. And that is the best way you could go into the sheds for the halftime.
He is not big for a number eight, but he is powerful. You see, he reached right in there and just pulled that ball out, and the maul just sort of parted like the Red Sea, and through he went.
That's just some gritty play there by Bowling Green. Tennessee again hanging in there with some extra effort. Great try scored, and quite a first half. That's the best part of the sport here, Alex. No one's ever counted out. Okay, it could go any which way.
Well, Nico LaBianca, I remember actually was fortunate enough to do play-by-play for that Division II championship that he won for Avon Lake, and he was a factor for sure, and he has a great future here. He's still a youngster, he's a class of 2024, so still some time to make an impact at Bowling Green Rugby. And the kick from Niemiller is away. And that is halftime. We will be back in just a few minutes for what is going to be a sparkling second half here in this D1AA final. Tennessee leading Bowling Green 31-19.
My major does not define me.
I'll probably be working jobs that don't exist yet.
I want a fulfilling career and to make a difference. A rewarding life starts with being true to yourself, then taking action. Our design coaches help identify what empowers you so you can think big, try boldly, and stay curious.
A BGSU education is bigger than a degree.
It's a toolkit.
For a life of purpose.
It takes a volunteer. Connected by a place and a shared sense of purpose. Inspired by possibilities, motivated by opportunities, and shaped by the spirit of a community like no other. Willing to step forward, ready to give our all. It takes courage to light the way. It takes a volunteer.
For some of you, we'll travel where no man has ever traveled before. Some of you will fly the fastest planes that have ever been built. I am impressed by the extraordinary scholastic record, unmatched by any new college or university in this country, by the students and graduates of this academy.
There's always been something special in Auburn. It gets into your very soul and never leaves you, ever. This past year reminded us what we're made of. It's what moves us upward. It's what moves us forward. It's what has always been and what will always be in Auburn. Learn more at auburn.edu.
When I was 16, I was in a near-fatal accident. The care I received saved my life and fueled my passion for rural medicine. Now I'm in medical school through Montana State University's WAMI program. Their mission of training physicians for rural Montana really aligns with mine. Through Montana WAMI, I'll be able to return to my community to care for others the way they cared for me.
Here, I test my limits. Here, I find my purpose.
Here, I attend a top-ranked school and am taught by the best.
Here, I am part of something bigger than myself.
Here, at the United States Naval Academy, we wear the Navy blue and gold.
Look around. Listen. There are a lot of tough questions. Questions about people and technology, about how we interact with our world and with each other. At Ohio State, we champion people and their potential to answer these tough questions. Like, how do we help people move? And how do we move people to advance innovations that create vibrant futures? Because here, anything, everything is possible.
Thank you.
All right, welcome back to halftime between Bowling Green and Tennessee in this D1AA final. Tennessee leading 31-19 here at the Mecklenburg County Sportsplex in North Carolina. I'm Alex Goff with Katie Wurst. And Katie, we have seen a back and forth barn burner kind of game.
I mean, here, it's just all about, I mean, there's just so much phenomenal work here. But Greg Janowick, he just straight away, it was the Janowick show for a little bit, right? I mean, look at that physicality and excitement. That's Tennessee on the front foot. And then this very deep conversion kick that was just a thing of beauty.
And then we saw the midfield getting a hand in there. Josh Shetler getting that break going. And then looked like that was that man again, Janowick, going in from short range for the second one. And it was all Tennessee at this point.
Yes, just, I mean, there was a flurry of tries scored, a lot of great action, but Bowling Green, they never said die, and they just worked hard on making sure that they could get where they needed to be. But that little bit of effort there was some beauty from William Ring. And between Ring and Janowick, they just made it very difficult for Bowling Green.
There's Pelini and Shetler again getting moving, and Luke Mathis in support running. And that ended up with the big man again, Janowick, pick and go, and the third try. And we had a 19-0 lead for Tennessee at that point.
This was Kubicki, just a great bit of individual effort, but it's off the back of a couple of penalties that were called for Tennessee. Bowling Green keeping themselves in this match, and this was sort of the turning point for them.
And back again comes Bowling Green, this time again punishing some penalties. A mall, and then it's the forwards consolidating pick and go. There's Hooper, and then we'll see Nico LaBianco will come in the headgear right there at the back of that, pick up and dive over for a key try. Beautiful kick there from Ryan Niemiller, and we had a ball game, 24-14.
And then as soon as Bowling Green starts to get on the road here, then Tennessee comes storming back, and they just use their brute physical force to get things done. And there was another series of penalties and a brilliant driving maul.
And then LaBianca right through the middle. As we said, the Red Sea parts. And he just led everybody through. Dive over in the corner. Lots of emotion, lots of physicality. Back and forth. The kicking game has been interesting. But right now, perhaps, Katie, the difference is you've got those two big guys, Janowick and Ring. Four tries between the two of them, powering through for Tennessee.
Right. Interestingly enough, though, Alex, it's kind of quite a battle when you consider the size differential between the two. Set pieces have been all about Bowling Green doing some phenomenal things.
Well, it's 31-19, so it was 24-0. And I think that was, at that point, if you're going to fall apart, that's when you fall apart. And instead, Bowling Green, since then, has put in three tries and has made a game of it. And we'll see what adjustments Tony Mazzarella has made for the Falcons and Bowling Green. They've had tough games before. They've fallen behind. And one of the things that I've noticed covering them this year and saw them in person, where they would actually, there was sort of like they would start chirping. They chirp with the referee. They chirp with each other, which is really odd. And sometimes that actually kind of fires them up. This time I haven't really seen them implode or turn on each other so much as just come together. At the same time, this Tennessee team has power and talent all over the place.
Right, definitely. I mean, they're a physical force. Like, between Ring, Janowick, as you mentioned, there's just Braxton Hurd as well, too. Very tough to bring down. But we've seen some great things from Bowling Green. Kyle Sikora and Kubicki, he's just genius in terms of looking at space, being able to attack it. Nico LaBianca, there's just too many great athletes we've seen here so far, and we're in for a treat for the second half.
A long kick driving in there for Tennessee as they restart it, and that's taken in by Zapila. Deep kick, getting under it, Rath. Gonna boot it down for Kubicki. Again, another deep one. He saw a lot of space behind. I think he was hoping that wouldn't go into touch and perhaps roll in, but he did make touch, and it's going to be a line out to Tennessee about 11 meters inside their own half. So again, we'll see a bit of a kicking contest.
Right. They're playing chess and checkers at this stage, Alex, really just going back and forth. It's all about where are we going to place the ball? Where is there space? How can we counter it? And it's something sometimes that can tire out some of the big men, too, as well, moving them back and forth around the field. But it's all about those specific skills as the lineout gets set. Well taken by Tennessee.
And out we go with McLean looking to use Pelini again. Big powerful run up the middle. Recycled quickly. McLean, left-footed kick. High, difficult to control. Well taken, though. Very well taken by Capizzi. And back out to the fullback, Chesnik. Lays it back, but he was isolated a little bit. Not enough players over the top. It will be a holding on penalty right there. And who was over quickly? It looked to me like that was Jance Williams for Tennessee to force that penalty.
I mean, that's just great effort play. You can see where they're a bit isolated. And that looks like they're going to take the points. Not a bad decision as well, really. It's all about getting that extra bit of insurance.
Understanding where you are. And Jake Rath right in front of the post. He's about 25 meters, 24 meters away. Really, he has the distance. He has the accuracy. He hit one from the touchline. That was certainly pretty to watch. 2 minutes in, 31-19. Tennessee leading, looking to make it 34-19 here. And the kick is up. And no good. He actually pulled it to the left. And I have to tell you, Katie, that those kicks that are right in front of the post can often be some of the most difficult. When you're at an angle, you start to think about angles. And here, you think about just kicking it straight down the middle. It's actually difficult.
Right. It's also about the approach as well, too. Just making sure that you can sight the target. You often see kickers like following the ball all the way through the line of sight.
Drop kick. Gone deep from Kubicki and is taken by Wallace, who charges up ahead. Exactly what a number eight should be doing. Ball comes out. Davies gets it to Janowick. Back out McLean. Now, oh, little miscommunication with Williams. Tennessee still has it. Or do they? No, it's been turned over. Bowling Green has it now. Kubicki gets it to Johnson. We've barely seen him run with the ball. Mock out to Choate. Choate down the line, taken down, and loses the ball forward. Tennessee still with it. Play on, says the referee. He's playing advantage on the knock on. And no advantage. A little bit of arm swinging, a couple of angry words exchanged between two of the players, but we will go back to the scrum.
The body language there says you better don't on both sides. They're really thinking about maybe that's not the way we want to take it. But, I mean, Bowling Green, that was just clinical, right? Very quickly, ball turned over, and they advance forward. Tennessee scramble back.
Josh Shetler looks to be coming off. He's pointing to some issue with his face. And he's being told by his coach to take a knee so that they would actually see that.
Looks like he's going to get a blood substitution here, which is a unique part of the sport where you can come off, get some medical attention, then come back on.
And so, yes, a bit of a blood problem. So he's trying to deal with it, and the referee hasn't seen him. So we're just sort of waiting for that. And so somebody throws some tape to him and tells him to take care of it himself. But it was a little bit more adventure there from Bowling Green. And we finally saw Joe Johnson with the ball a little bit. And then he dishes it off and connected with his center partner Tony Mock, and then Kobe Choate coming in. So Katie, will we be seeing perhaps a little bit more risk-taking from Bowling Green as we go through this game?
Right, sir. See Kobe Choate right now. He's kind of swinging his arm back and forth. It's probably one of the tougher things. Landed on it, maybe a bit tough. But I really think there are so many attacking opportunities here for Bowling Green if they can get the ball wide. we haven't seen all that potentially could come from the Bowling Green backline.
Well, Timothy Yeager is coming in as a blood substitute for Josh Shetler, and that'll be a little bit of a shift for Tennessee. We'll see if Shetler is able to get back on the field. And we're back with the action. Davies putting in the scrum, a big shove from Bowling Green. Tennessee pops up. It's play on. And they work Rath up through the middle. Davies now back to McLean. McLean ready to clear it. Good deep kick straight down the middle. Chesnick needs a little bit of help. Griffin Black goes over it. And a big drive from Tennessee, but coming in a little bit from the side, that's Williams, who's been very active. And Sikora mixing it up with a couple of players from the Tennessee team.
We'll take another look at it here. Really, that good deep kick went exactly to the waiting hands for Bowling Green. And here was a beautiful clear out straight away. And then just going into the side, turning that body angle a little bit.
And the kick to touch, so it'll be a line out for Bowling Green at the 22 of Tennessee. John Stuhldreher from St. Ignatius High School in Cleveland. And he'll be throwing it in. And Hooper goes up, he taps it back, gathered by LaBianca. He charges ahead, he's not taken down. Still going forward is LaBianca. Picked up, Hooper. And once again, the forwards take it ahead by Bowling Green. But they've lost it. Taken away by Tennessee. Janowick eyes up the two biggest players and goes runs straight at him. Davies back. And Rath kicking it. Makes touch, doesn't make a lot of ground. And that will be a line out for Bowling Green. And a little bit disappointing for Bowling Green there. They were moving ahead and then lose possession.
Right, it's all about keeping the ball in hand, making sure that you don't turn it over. And then to Tennessee, I really like the approach of thinking around, let's just clear it, let's get it out. So, but just went off the wrong part of his foot. So still in good position, but for Bowling Green, there's an opportunity there. Lineups have been working for him if they can use it.
Signal comes in from Cody Luther, and they go to the front. Choate and the ball on the ground. But that's all right. You can put the ball on the ground in the mall like that. And penalty. Holding on. And they went straight to ground. And they, once again, Tennessee got somebody over that ball immediately.
I think, too, it might have been potentially not rolling away as well. Just didn't get quickly enough off the ground.
And you'll see in this line out Christopher Jennings Evans, who had shared words with Kwasi Sikora earlier. He is a new line out threat. They got a taller player in for Ring, did Tennessee. And he's in the scrum half position right now, and he's going to step in somewhere. And Jennings Evans takes it. And immediately it comes back. Davies to McLean. Out the back. And they're looking to free up the wing. And that'll be a break. He's beaten one. He's beaten two. He's going into the corner. It is a try. A huge try from Tennessee. All through the back line. A quick ball out of the line out. And out to the left.
We just got to take a look at the air from the set piece. As you said, brought in some height for this line out. And look at this ball movement, right? Goes right across, runs the dummy runners out, and then quick hands, as you like. And then there's just speed for breakfast right here as he gets right around.
And that is Austin White. Speed for breakfast, I like that. Speed. Austin White taking it to the house. The criminology major from Tennessee. He's a local kid and his career goals, he says federal, so I guess he wants to go FBI. Sounds like an FBI man. Well, he knows how to score tries from long range out, and that was a real body blow for Bowling Green to take because they've been in the attacking position in the Tennessee half, and then to give that one up, that's got to hurt.
And I mean, that's just phenomenal stuff, Alex. That's like any wing watching is like, this is the setup, right? You know that it's coming. You saw, I mean, he started his run like about two phases before the ball even got to him, right? That kind of bursting speed coming onto it. There's not much that Bowling Green can do to counter from that. But they also didn't contest too much at the line out as well, too. They saw the height coming in. So this is really some tough stuff, looking really strong as Tennessee at this point.
Very clean line out take, certainly helped them. The kick not over, and so it'll stay at 36-19.
Bowling Green, though, what we've seen is they've always found a way to come back, right? They dig deep, and they make good decisions. They draw a few penalties, and they use their set piece. Let's see if that's going to happen again. They really have no quit in them.
Taken by Tennessee. Immediately roll forward 4 or 5 meters. Wallace pops it back inside. They're moving the ball now. A couple of little offloads. Davies digs it out. Janowick. Surges ahead, back out Davies to McLean, looking to use Pellini, but he drops the ball, and he dropped the ball backwards the first time, picked it up, then was hit and dropped the ball forwards. So it'll be a scrum to Bowling Green. And once again, Kyle Sikora in the middle of all the action, flying in with that tackle.
Yes, really, that's just good old-fashioned apply pressure. Make sure you can force him to make a mistake. And here's an opportunity for Bowling Green, right? They're in good position here. They can certainly use it to get that momentum going in their direction.
So they were able to get something going. They're able to get something going from the scrum earlier, but we're going to take a break here. We're just going to check on, actually, Christopher Jennings-Evans. He got a little knock to the head, so they're just going to have a look and see how he feels. And it was interesting earlier as they check, you know, player safety, very important. There was a moment, I was at the Bowling Green Western Michigan game much earlier this year, and one of the players from Bowling Green got a knock to the head, and it was actually his teammate. It was actually Ryan Niemiller who sat down and did a quick injury assessment with him. As you see, the bodies come flying in. Jennings Evans comes in, and just as he dives on the ball, Sikora's shin just comes and hits him in the head, and they're going to take him off and have a look. But it was actually Niemiller who did the assessment and told his teammate, you've got to go off. I don't think you're safe. And that is good idea of putting player safety, even when you're in the heat of battle, putting player safety ahead of everything else. So the substitute who's made an impact comes off, and coming on is Konstantinos Anderson, and that may be a temporary, that may be a permanent sub. We will see what happens. Keep saying Konstantinos Anderson. I really want Konstantinos Anderson to get into this game, and every time I say it, it's not him. Sorry. Jarrett Self coming in, number 16.
Yes, definitely prioritize the safety of student-athletes' well-being, but again, came and made a big impact, really made a decision, so job well done.
So that was Thomas Codeville going off after making that impact in the lineout.
That was an impressive clearance. Took out two Bowling Green players. Now Janowick with the ball in hand.
McLean. Shetler. Oh, what a great offload as he was falling. Just a great chance there for Moolman. And just taken into touch, but some adventure now as they keep running Janowick up the middle, and he gets harder and harder to stop as we go along.
Some credit to John Stolderher there as well, too. Quite a tackle he made. Just wrapped up the legs, got him to ground. Bowling Green's just had to play a lot of defense so far, and there's something to be said about never giving up, going after it. Here was the pickup.
That's Williams. What a great offload there. And Janowick just steamrolling players.
This is, look at, all just comes from out of nowhere and wraps up the legs, probably saves a try.
Not straight on the throw. It'll be a scrum for Tennessee. Bowling Green just not able to piece those puzzle pieces together at the moment.
That's just an unfortunate unforced error there. So one that Tennessee is liking the field position they're in if they can take advantage of it.
And in fact, they're going for the lineout, which is rare, but we do see that happening.
You get the sense maybe they want to get it as wide as possible. We saw what they could do. And Bowling Green, we've seen, like, their scrum definitely has some advantages in terms of their body position. They're low to the ground. So probably just an effort to get the ball moving fast.
Self takes it, but it is not straight that time. Bowling Green doesn't hesitate. They'll pick the scrum. And back to a put in for the Falcons. Falcons will need to get out of trouble here. They're looking at that scoreboard. They're not too far behind. You get one converted try and you're right back in it. They got plenty of time.
Both teams unfortunately checking the box for that. Not straight, the unfortunate skill set. It's very difficult to throw from the line out, get it to the intended target, and do so within timing.
Knee Miller with the put in for Bowling Green. Nice solid scrum out to Kubicki. He hoofs it down the field. It's a wobbly one, but it's taken nicely by Black. Beats one tackler, is taken down by the second. Tennessee has it. Off we go. Williams. Excuse me. I think that was Hurd. McLean. McLean bobbles it, but he gets out of trouble. Kubicki had him in his sights. Sikora takes him down. Another tackle by Kyle Sikora. Up they go with Thomas. Hurd pops it up. Out, nice tackle there from Hooper. Dug out again, Janowick. Hit low, but he needs a second to take him down. Stuhldreher not big enough. McLean, the chip through, the grubber is right there. All kinds of problems for Bowling Green. Capizzi trying to gather it. And one of them, at least one of those chasers was offside. And Katie, that was so on.
Right, I mean, that's just great creative play there. Like, making an effort, you try again, and really full credit, that's a testament to Bowling Green's defensive effort, right? They haven't found a way to break through, so let's kick it through, see what we can do.
The chasers, they had the numbers on the chase, and Kubicki trying to get as much territory as possible, does not make touch. Rath, instead, is going to kick it deep. Choate under it. And another long kick. Go, Tennessee returns that. Getting under it. Now we'll see what Bowling Green can do. Mock gets it out. The cutback inside. Griffin Black has it. Hooper. Miller out to Kubicki. Mock, he's got Johnson. He skips over Johnson. And that's Choate, the flanker, who made that break earlier. His shoulder looks to be feeling a little bit better. Zapila. The second row. Now Kubicki. LaBianca lets it go smartly. McBride has it, the prop. They've lost it forward. Penalty, in fact. He lost it forward, and then LaBianca dove onto the ball. Pretty dangerous stuff from Bowling Green. Once again, they lose the ball in the 22.
Right, take a look here. Just some great decision in terms of the kick and then the counterattack, right? Coming back at him. This was a nice bit of evasion and support. Just there, just enough time. Tennessee going for it. So, and really, Bowling Green, you've got to say that they had the slight edge in terms of that kicking battle back and forth, creating some really good dynamic attacking go forward. Counterattack, point one to Bowling Green.
Well, missed touch again. Griffin Black took it. Kubicki hoofs it downfield. all the way, and in fact, it's touchdown in goal, so that will be a goal line dropout, which is actually a pretty good payoff for Bowling Green there. If it rolls into rolls past the dead ball line, then it's scrum back from where he kicked it. But if it stays in goal like that, it's a goal line dropout.
I think it also does change the sort of frantic momentum that was going on, Alex. Like, that was working for Bowling Green. You saw just they lost that energy when that penalty was called. You know, how they that was really working for them. They play like a very up-tempo attack style.
Now, the one to get it to is Joe Johnson, number 13 for Bowling Green. We haven't really seen much of him in terms of running with the ball. And Tennessee kicks it as far away from Johnson as they possibly can. Black has it. He's got Stuhldreher with him. He tries to offload. He loses it. Instead, Mathis takes it, the flanker for Tennessee. And another chance goes begging for Bowling Green. Janowick takes the return pass, but it is forward and a scrum for Bowling Green.
I mean, there was a lot of force in that tackle, and that's just what it was created. We saw a lot of that so far. It's just the pure physicality of these contests is what's causing the loss of possession.
Kevin Thomas, very unhappy with himself, and says, yeah, my fault. And one of the things you never want to see is that you make a mistake, you want to be able to fix it, and they've subbed him out because it's time to sub him out. Brendan Bibb comes in for him, and he's just unhappy to leave on that note, because that little give and go he was going with Janowick was working quite nicely. So we'll go back to that first knock on, the attempted offload that didn't quite make it, and it'll be a scrum for Tennessee. We also see coming on for Bowling Green, Ronnie Morton comes in at prop, and he'll be getting his first action, packing down right now at loose head. Davies puts it in. Good scrum for Tennessee. McLean now trying to send Pelini up the middle. Where's that ball? And he was isolated. Nobody came over. Penalty for Bowling Green. They're going to tap quickly. Stuhldreher straight up the middle. Bowling Green still has it. The pick and go, once again, another pick and go. Morton gets in on the action.
Bowling Green's definitely taking this the hard way, having good support, drawing in the defense now.
Johnson with a chance, and he is dragged down nicely. Good defense from Tennessee. Bowling Green still has it. Luther getting close. And there comes the new man, Ronnie Morton. But we'll go back for a penalty offside. And once again, I think they're going to tap it. Sikora wants to tap it. Referee says no. A little bit of a chat, but Bowling Green right on the doorstep. They may choose to tap and run a move here anyway.
Right, it was interesting, that inline that he ran right towards the fringe of the breakdown. It drew the penalty either way. So, good decision. You want to look for finding the seam, right? So, if you run right at him, you're not going to go anywhere but backwards. But making sure you run at the branches of the tree and not the trunk.
And we are back. Time back on. The tap by Kubicki gets it out to LaBianca. LaBianca dragged just short of the line by Mathis. The pickup, it's over the line and held up. Another goal line dropout. And that looked to be Sikora, who had picked it up and went over, but he was flipped over, held up, and Katie, so close.
Right, just a tough one there. It's just that little bit of lack of patience. Coming over, you're right on the line and just trying to get the job done. But, I mean, really heroic defense there for Tennessee.
Well, we saw Janowick able to score because he stayed low and he was so big. Powers people over. Very nice take there from Travis Reba.
Difficult catch over the shoulder for sure. Nice counterattack.
Chesnick He's taken down, but they're able to get it out quickly. Once again, Morton charges ahead. And that's Everett, Xavier Everett. Kubicki, a little bit of show and go there. Mock, Stuhldreher, back to Reba. Morton wants it. Tennessee defense just holding firm right now. Out to Johnson. Johnson and Mock nicely linked, and Mock just somehow gets it out. I don't know how he did that. Chesnick linking up with the outside backs. That's Choate. Back to the 22 now, Bowling Green. A big skip pass. Who has it? Who's going to get it? And not good news for Bowling Green if that's what they had to work with, but we're going to call a penalty, I think.
I mean, you have to give credit for Bowling Green. Like, there's so much heart here. They're never quitting. They just keep pushing forward, right? They have to put together two or three plus extra phases of play just to be able to see how they can gain any ground.
And that one was for pushing Casacora when he didn't have the ball and the ball was rolling on the ground. And that kick just barely made it into touch. A really nice play from Garrett Mulman to try and keep it in. But line out for Bowling Green. This is a big one now with about 13, 14 minutes left in this game. Bowling Green 18 points behind, and really, if they want to make this comeback, they've got to get a try soon.
This is kind of the do or die opportunity here, Alex. Like, you couldn't ask for a better platform. It's something that they've been really successful with. This is, we got to get that throw in, hit the target, keep composed, and really orchestrate exactly what you've been working on in training for the entire season. It's now coming down to this, and for Tennessee, you know, you can't let anything go, right? Make sure that you're still pouring on the pressure, not taking your foot off the gas.
The throw in, nobody was expecting that one. And there is just a mental error from somebody. They still seem to be discussing what to do with that throw in when the ball was thrown in.
I mean, that's it, right? It's that little bit of lack of communication, just one miscue. But, you know, it's still Bowling Green scrum, so, which is something that they've been dominant in before. So sometimes, you know, even though it's not going to be what you wanted it to be, it could turn out to be something even better.
You should put that on a poster.
I mean, certainly. Yeah. For rugby, that's what it's all about, right? It's a bounce of the ball one way or the other.
Right.
Okay, set pieces, you go from one set piece to the other. One of them's not going to work. The other one gives you another chance. It's really about what you do with the opportunity in front of you.
Back line set up for Bowling Green. Good drive. LaBianca tried to run, flicked it out to Kubicki. Mock to Johnson. Johnson taken down. The defense has been very strong, and Shetler made a good tackle there. Stuhldreher drives up ahead. But right over the top, and that was Self, Jarrett Self. He's made an impact when he's come in. I don't think he was expecting to play.
I mean, that was the best effort there straight away. Get right over the ball, right? Tackle happens, get to your feet as quick as you like, and then he just made a big play.
That's a huge one for Tennessee, and once again, they get out of it. Four, maybe five visits to the 22 by Bowling Green in this second half, and we have not seen them execute once they get into those scoring opportunities.
I mean, they've maintained possession several times. They've had to work really hard for it, and that's for Tennessee. You get the sense they're playing a little bit more conservative, and, you know, it's also some of that fatigue that's starting to come in, really. It's quite a physical match, and they're just, at this point, you know, keep them out. If they don't score any more points, we're still in a good position.
Out it comes to the back line again. McLean looking Shetler. Had Rath with him, but it took it up. And loose ball, turnover. LaBianca was right there, so Bowling Green has it back again. Hooper, Johnson. Johnson trying to break a tackle. Took two to break him down. And Hooper picks it up again. Goes straight up the middle. Bowling Green back inside the Tennessee 22. 12 minutes to go. Down by 18. 17, excuse me. Everett takes it up. Morton. Well tackled there. Tennessee's defense going. Then they work a move, try to get Johnson free. He's taken down by three players. Mock. Mock now. Little dummy. Offloads. Chesnick out to Choate. Choate dropped it. Dropped it backward. Just dropped it forward, and it was right there. Three on two, and somehow with a tackle once again by Shetler.
Just some heartbreaking timing there, Alex. They were so close. It was just about there. Right, Kubicki moving the ball quickly. And just, I mean, extra effort. We've seen them. Come on, Bowling Green. Phenomenal work by Joe Johnson. He's been everywhere. And then this is it. So it's unselfish play, right? The pass was just a little bit behind, right? The one where you try to catch it in your armpit and it doesn't go anywhere but down.
So White and Rath getting in on those tackles as well, along with Shetler. Great cover defense from Tennessee. We have about maybe a little bit more than 12 minutes to go. We've got a sub coming on for Bowling Green, and that would be Jake Hudak. He's coming on to bolster that forward pack. And Hudak, another Avon product. Freshman and, computer science major comes on, and the shoulder I think has done all it can to Kobe Choate, that had actually a very active, terrific game. Another Avon product. Avon kid for Avon kid comes off.
Cleveland representing strong here. Quite a contest, and so many impact substitutions have been made, and on both sides, really coming in and making a big difference, adding some more height or adding just a little bit, you know, a fresh set of legs makes a big difference.
Big drive from Bowling Green. And referee says it's just spinning, no particular reason for it, so we're just going to reset.
We've got to talk about Bowling Green has a lot of tension within what they're doing with their binding, everything else. It really is truly dominant. When you consider just, you know, size does matter in some areas in terms of how much weight they're actually pushing, but they really are technically very sound.
And it was interesting that Tennessee subbed off William Ring, and I think they lost some size in the second row there. They went because they wanted Codeville to jump in the lineout, I think. But in the end, Tennessee has it, but very well tackled. Stuhldreher right on the tackle. Perfectly done. LaBianca comes in to poach it and forces a holding on penalty. Great work from the back row from Bowling Green, and they are going to, well, they've been tapping it. I think they'll tap it this time as well. Nee Miller.
Runs right into the pile.
Yeah. Kubicki now working mock. Johnson. Johnson puts a move on. A little bit high. And he drives over. Are we going to get held up again? Yes, we're going to get held up again. That one really forced by Tennessee. They had him in control, and they said, well, you know what? Why don't we just drag him over? We'll hold him up, and then we just kick it away.
It's about the third or fourth actual certain try that's been somehow just pulled up, right? It's that upper body strength, the ability to just hang on, okay? Get your hands underneath. Make sure the ball's got to touch the ground. That's so frustrating, Alex, for Bowling Green. I mean, they're doing all things right, and then the last minute, just take one more evasive step, right? Get a little bit lower, and you're going to get over.
And the kick. Nee Miller is under it. And, in fact, so is Reba. Reba connecting with Chesnick. Chesnick taken down hard. Morton, been very active since he's come on. Exactly what you want an impact sub to do. Kubicki now looking to use Everett. Skips Everett, pops it off to Sikora. Mark now. Dummies, everybody's keying on Johnson, but he managed to get by and get it out to Johnson. Johnson breaks another tackle, down to 2 meters out. Bowling Green still has it. Niemiller wants them to pick and go. Hooper. Another pickup this time by Hudak. Was that a knock on? Was that good? No, that is going to be a try. Cody Luther finally gets it over. It has been rough sledding for Bowling Green to get it over that line and onto the ground. Held up two or three times, as you said. Knock-ons four or five times in the 22, but it is a try, and it is a huge try for Bowling Green.
Definitely sunnier skies there. Bowling Green finally finding a way, right? It's just making sure that you can do whatever's necessary. That is so tough to defend over and over and over. You got to give some credit to Tennessee for holding them out as long as they did. But that's the stuff that just shows you're never going to quit. So for Bowling Green, those extra points, those are ones that are well earned. Take another look at it. There was a little bit of misdirection and that throw off the corner. And this was some really good stuff in terms of Johnson finally getting over the line, getting a little bit lower in body position. Niemiller just orchestrating exactly what needs to happen. He does such a phenomenal job around being able to communicate. You love that to see that in your number nine.
And the kick is up and good. From the sideline, it looked like maybe it wouldn't have the legs, but it had the height and the legs. Niemiller gets his side within 10 now, within two unconverted tries, or critically, a penalty goal puts them within shouting distance. So if you look at the time clock on the screen, it is actually a little bit fast. So right now it says we've got 5 minutes to go. We have more like 7 minutes left in this game.
I mean, Alex, that'd be a story for the ages. Pull it within 10, right? It's still absolutely not a done deal yet.
24-0 and a penalty against Tennessee. And so once again, Bowling Green gets out of trouble. 24-0 Tennessee led.
You get a sense of just a little bit of tension, right? Some uneasiness from Tennessee. And that's Bowling Green, right? After they finally got the payout, right? Going forward as much as they possibly could, finally get over the line. And now all of a sudden there's some belief, right? You look up, you see we're within 10 points. Let's see what more we can do.
How great is this? And Hudson Tefelski is coming on. There's a sub for... There's a discussion as to who he's coming on for. I think that might be Chesnick that he comes on for. Well taken. Short line out. I think that's what they wanted to do that last time. LaBianca takes it straight ahead. The ball is popped loose illegally, not rolling away. So that is the thing that you have to get up and release the tackle player, but you have to get out of that immediate tackle area.
I mean, penalties are going to be what kills you, right? It's just giving the ball back, right? And Bowling Green's going to take advantage of it. They'll keep moving upfield, and here's where some real composure is going to matter, right? For Tennessee, got to make good choices, do what they can to contest, get possession, and don't give it up.
Well taken by Hooper. Stoldreyer. Niemiller, Kubicki, the dummy. They were looking to cut off his pass, and he saw that coming. Out it comes again, this time with Hudak trying to get something going. Bowling Green going backwards. Lots of space out to the left for Bowling Green. Tennessee just sort of clumped in the middle of the field. And out we go. Johnson now pops it off. Nice little pass on the outside. Nobody with him.
Plenty of space to the outside, Alex. They can just move the ball.
And once again, a wide pass. Morton. Excuse me, no, that was Tefelski. Tofelsky, a big body in the midfield. He's taken down, and once again, they don't roll away. And referee is going to halt the clock. And we may be going to the pocket because there's been a number of penalties in the ruck. And this time, Tom Wallace is in trouble. Yellow card, repeated penalties. At this point, I think that's reasonable there, Katie. We've seen the same penalty time after time. At some point, referee says it's just been too many.
Right, so now playing a man down. Here's something, Bowling Green, how can you capitalize? Well, how are you gonna take advantage of this? We're gonna kick it. We're running out of time here at some point, right? It's gotta be up tempo. You're down 10 points. We know that they have some brilliant kickers, some people that can absolutely take advantage of the penalty kick if that's what's needed and necessary.
Defense now is the name of the game for Tennessee, and they certainly will want to defend this line out. Can't spend a lot of time deciding what you're going to do. And he goes straight to LaBianca up the front, and then work it around for Amal. Amal falls over. Pick and go. Pick and go again. A lot of urgency for Bowling Green. Sakura's in there. Hooper's in there. Luther, the try scorer, he's in there too. Everett wants it out, outside channel, stretches over, doesn't quite make it, slides it back. Kubicki tries to go himself, two players taken. He gets down, Niemiller out to Johnson, and Johnson is destroyed. High tackle.
That's such a tough penalty there. Ugh. Just a wave of defense coming up, and Johnson.
And that's going to be a card again. And I think this is it. This is interesting because of how the clock is managed. Remember, we're a bit two minutes off on the clock, so.
That's a second card that just came out, Alex.
Yep. But that goes in, and they hit him pretty hard around the head area, and Johnson is still on the ground. And so Tennessee will end this game with 13 players. Have a look at this. Well, you know, from that angle, it's tough to see.
I mean, his body height, he was just standing upright.
Yeah. But we see most of the contact we see from that angle was on the torso. But on the far side of that, we didn't quite see what his left arm did to come in and make a tackle. But referee was right there. He didn't like it. And it's a card, a yellow card, and it'll go back to a penalty, the original penalty perhaps. And players are urging for urgency. They want to move it. And the tap, and Sakura goes in low. And he is denied the line. Hooper picks it up. He goes straight ahead to the line. Referee is right there. Kubicki out wide, and Reba. Travis Reba is in with the try, and it is 36-31. We do have time. We have about 2.5 minutes left.
And they wave off the kick. Great decision here because they still need it, right? Get right back to it so you can make that restart happen. Tennessee's got to dig deep. They got to find it, right? Finish it. It's all about finishing.
And that was a smart choice from Ryan Niemiller. That is a player who understands the laws. We don't want to take the kick. We don't want to spend the time with it. And it's out on the touchline anyway. Why bother? He didn't think it's difficult to make that. So now we have a five-point game, 36-31. Who would have thought? Everett goes in, collides with his own player. And Tennessee has it. Tennessee has hardly seen the ball for quite some time. Janowick just picks it up and consolidates. He's not really worried too much. Now the question is, see that, remember we talked about this, the clock on the scoreboard, the clock you see on the screen is the clock the players see on the scoreboard. The referee is keeping time. And there's a knock on, referee says, that is a scrum. So we're still playing, and the players have to be aware of when the game is actually over to kick it and end the game.
Right, and this is where really the management of the match official, the clock, everything comes down to it. The leadership you have, it's about those critical last second decisions. You know, we went from a 19-0 score game to now every second counts.
Just a classic, stirring comeback from Bowling Green. They were down and almost out. And then come back.
It's also just a tale of the impact substitutions coming in, making changes, how you manage that. One of the most difficult challenges for both sets of coaches is how do we figure out how we finish the job.
Big shove, they kick it to touch. And that is your ball game. Champions, University of Tennessee, hold on after a stirring comeback from Bowling Green. Katie Wurst, what a fantastic game.
I mean, just it turned into, there was pretty much everything that could have possibly transpired within a contest, a championship contest, right? There was dominance at certain points, there was comebacks, there was literally everything you could ask for, and just a whole lot of heart and grit, right? To see they left everything on the field. You look at Bowling Green right now as the Tennessee Volunteers are celebrating, but that is competition. That's something you're gonna fight to the very end.
Well, a huge sigh of relief for Tennessee and perhaps some tears for Bowling Green, but they also look themselves in the mirror and say, you know, we didn't back down. We came right back at them and didn't capitulate. It was, I believe, we have to check, 24-0 at one point. It was definitely 19-0 at one point, and they came back to 36-31. They never led Bowling Green, but they were in it with a shot, one more shot, and had they been able to get that ball, perhaps, who knows?
Right, and all you can ask for your opponents is to keep them on edge straight to the last minute of play, right? There are definitely points where Tennessee thought they were coasting, and Bowling Green stuck into that match, but true dominance from the Volunteers. We had multiple try scorers, just some examples of really high intensity, high pace of play on attack, and I mean goal line defense. How many times did Tennessee keep them out, right? There's so many tries denied. You can't ask for more than that.
And interesting, you talked about impact subs, and they brought on Thomas Codeville because there was, I saw an injury to William Ring. Codeville comes in, wins a critical line out that sets up Austin White's try in the corner. And then he gets hurt, but he made an impact there. There's Janowick scoring.
I mean, one of many that he had all day. And I mean, there was just such a back and forth effort there, right? Like, in terms of what they were doing for scrummaging Kubicki, this was the first one with that fend off. This was really what lighted the fire for Bowling Green. It really made the big difference. It kind of gave them that self-belief.
And then LaBianca charging through. He had a big game. And you see White here. This run is his real chance to do that. And what a fantastic sidestep inside, outside. Brilliant try. And that was the critical. In a way, I mean, that was the game sealer. That was their last try. They didn't really get a sniff.
Right, and you saw Coach Marty Bradley really just embracing the athletes. There's so much that, you know, goes into this. So a battle back and forth through, you know, all the way to the very end. And no quit, a constant fight, and that's what championship rugby is all about.
And everybody needed all 23 of their players, that's for sure. And this was, this was a classic. And both teams have been talking about this a lot, and I think it's fair to talk about. There's a difference between teams where the coaches are employed and teams where the university gives them facilities or makes them varsity, gives them varsity status, and club teams. And here, these are club teams. These are teams that they get the support they have, comes from their alumni and from the players.
As we get set for the trophy presentations here to see representatives from USA Rugby and the crowd reacting to the MVP.
And there it is, your MVP, Greg Janowick, a huge presence in the set piece, but also those three tries at the beginning of the game were massive for Tennessee. And the runner-up trophy, and someone who might have put two players who might have put a hand on the MVP trophy, Kyle Sikora and John Stuhldreher, coming out to receive the runner-up trophy.
Kyle Sikora, he just did everything possible for Bowling Green. He was there all the time making great choices. Ryan Niemiller as well. He made, you know, especially waiting until the last minutes, made big differences here.
Tennessee volunteers coming in to take it. Janowick comes back out.
Alex, there's nothing like a championship trophy right there. You know, it's all about the effort, raising that high above with your teammates, thinking all the long hours you put in, the travel, every minute, you know, the bumps, the bruises, it's all worth it in the end.
Marcus McLean, the other co-captain, bringing it in amongst his teammates. And congratulations to the University of Tennessee. And thank you everybody for joining us here at Matthews, North Carolina, where Tennessee has defeated Bowling Green 36-31 here at the Mecklenburg County Sportsplex. And for Katie Wurst and our entire crew, I'm Alex Goff saying thanks for watching. Any rebroadcast of the pictures, audio, and accounts from this match are strictly prohibited without express written permission from the Rugby Network and CRAA.